Hachette Audio presents Behind the Throne, The Indranan Wars, Book 1. Written by KB Wagers. Read by Angèle Masters. To all the women who inspire me on the daily, past, present, and future generations, I am here because I stood on the shoulders of Amazons. Chapter 1.
Hail. Get up.
The voice cut through the nausea, sounding too much like my father. I suppose it made sense in some twisted way. If I were dead, it wasn't completely illogical to be hearing the voice of a man who'd been shot in front of me 21 years ago. The bitter tang of blood filled my mouth and nose when I inhaled. Rusted iron and the awful smell of death. The stale air of a carrion house screamed of the violence that had taken place in my cargo bay, violence I couldn't remember through the pounding of my head.
Hail! Get up now!
Whoever's voice was in my head, it was enough to make me move, or at least try to. I scrambled to my feet, pain stealing what grace the gods had gifted me. My boots, gorgeous red-black Holicon 4s I'd borrowed from a dead raider 6 months prior, slipped on the blood-slick metal. I went down hard, cracking my already abused face on the deck, and the world greyed out for a moment. More pain flared when I tried to flop over onto my back and failed. All right. So, not dead. Because even now, at my most cynical, I didn't believe for an instant the gods let you still feel pain after you died. It just didn't seem proper.
Look at this mess.
This voice was outside my head, which made it infinitely more dangerous. I froze, face down, in what smelled like someone else's guts. Judging by the events filtering back into my brain, I suspected the guts belonged to my navigator. A vague memory of trying to strangle her with her own intestines flashed before my eyes. Mems had been a tough bitch. She'd landed a few good punches before I'd given up and broken her neck.
Weakly saints preserve us.
I heard several other curses from behind me, but the high, lilting call for the saints to my left was what caught my attention. It was edged with a Farian accent, and that was enough to keep me from moving. Farians. An alien race who could kill or heal with a touch. The only thing that kept them from ruling the universe was some strange religious code enforced with a fanaticism privately envied by most governments. They had 7 saints, one for each day of the week. It was the Thursday one, I think, who abhorred violence. According to Farian scripture, he'd set an edict on their power. It was to be used for healing, not death. Killing people with their power drove Farians crazy. I'd never seen it firsthand, but the vids I'd seen had given me nightmares. Grief-stricken, screaming Farians held down by their own comrades as an executioner put them out of their misery. Not moving was a good idea. Anathema or not, there was always a chance this Farian was ghost-shit insane, and I didn't have a gun.
You claimed to sense a life sign, Sergeant.
A female voice, several octaves lower than the Farian's, didn't so much ask the question as pick up a previous conversation.
Did, Cap. In this room. Only one.
The lilting voice replied.
That's as close as I can pinpoint it.
Fine. Fan out and check through this.
The owner of the voice paused, but I resisted the urge to lift my head and see if she was looking around the cargo hold.
Rubble,
she finished, finally.
Sergeant Terras says one of these poor sods is alive. Figure out which one.
I kept my eyes closed, counting the footsteps as my unwelcome guests fanned out around me. There were 5 people total, all moving with military precision. They were probably fucking mercs come to claim my ship. I hadn't been able to figure out whom Portis, my bastard of a first officer, thought he was going to sell Sophie to when he started his little mutiny. You mean when you killed him? Grief dug razor claws into my throat, and I choked back a sob. God's damn you, Portis. Why did you betray me? Except I wasn't entirely sure he'd been trying to kill me, or that I'd been the one to kill him in the end. My memory of the fight was as fuzzy as a passacol sheep and had teeth just as sharp. Trying to dredge up anything resembling coherency made the pain in my head turn on me with snarling fury. I snarled back at it, and it dove away, whimpering, into the recesses of my brain. There were more important matters at hand, like getting these bastards off my ship and getting the hell out of here. Sliding my hand through the gelling blood on the floor, I wiggled my fingers deep into the thick, squishy mess. A spark of triumph flared to life when I closed my hand around the hilt of my combat knife. I knew it was mine, because I felt the nick in the handle, even through all the gore. The day was a fucking waste, but at least I was armed. The intruders moved past me. By some grace, I'd ended up partially beneath the stairs and out of sight. I eased myself sideways, rolling over Portis's torso and away from the abstract blood painting on the floor. I saw his profile, and all at once I wanted to kick him, curse his name, and drop to my knees and beg him not to leave. There's no time for this, Hale. You have to move. The voice I now recognized as my own damn survival instinct shouted at me with the crisp precision of an imperial drill sergeant. I got my feet under me and rose into a crouch. My left leg protested the movement, but held my weight. The strangers had their backs to me. I almost thanked the gods for it, and then reminded myself there was nothing the gods of my homeworld had done for me lately. Portis had been the believer, not me. The dim emergency lighting might be just enough for me to slide into the shadows and make it to the door. The ship's AI wasn't responding to my smarties' requests for information. At this point, I couldn't tell if I'd been hit by a disruptor that had shorted the hardware wired into my brain, or if the problem was with Sophie. Either way, it didn't matter. I had to get to the bridge and access the computer manually. If I could space these jokers, I would be long gone before they finished imploding. If. I backed straight into the 6th intruder before I had time to remind myself what if stood for. He was hidden by the shadows I was trying to blend into, as still and silent as a ghost. He didn't make a sound when I spun and drove my right hand into his ribs. The blue shimmer of his personal shield flared, and I swore under my breath. It would smother any strike I threw at him, making the damage laughable. But the kinetic technology didn't extend to his unprotected head, so I swung my left up toward his throat, blade first. He caught my wrist, twisting it back and away from his head. I matched him in height, and judging by the surprised flaring of his dark eyes, we were nearly equal in strength. We stood locked for a stuttering heartbeat until he drove me back a step. Sophie's emergency lighting made the silver tattoo on his left cheekbone glow red. My heart stopped. The Imperial Star, an award of great prestige, was an intricate diamond pattern. The 4 spikes turned slightly widdershins. But what had my heart starting again and speeding up in panic was the twisted black emblem on his collar. He was an Imperial tracker. Bugger me. The curse slipped out before I could stop it, slipped out in the old tongue as my shock got the better of me. There was only one reason for a tracker team to be here. The reason I'd spent the best part of 20 years avoiding anything.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.